Epithelial tissue is our first type of tissue that we will learn about in this chapter. Epithelial tissue is tissue that covers surfaces, and we're probably used to thinking about surfaces on the outside of the body. Your skin is a great example of something that's made up of epithelial tissue primarily, but we also have a lot of surfaces inside the body, a lot of internal surfaces, and epithelial tissue also lines those surfaces. So, what are some of the functions of epithelial tissue? Well, if you think about your skin, what does your skin do for you? For one thing, it protects the inside of your body. It provides a barrier between you and the rest of the world. So there is a protective function, but it also gives some special characteristics in certain locations, right? There are certain areas on your skin where maybe your skin needs to be producing certain substances. It could be sweat, could be saliva inside of your mouth. And so the epithelial tissue is the thing that allows those special properties. Some examples of epithelial tissues other than skin, we'll be revisiting skin actually later on in this chapter, so we'll come back to that. But other examples would be the lining inside of blood vessels. The surface inside of a blood vessel needs to be very smooth. If it wasn't smooth, if it was rough, then that would mess up the blood flow. But the fact that there is a very smooth layer of epithelial tissue allows that blood flow to go very smoothly and not experience a lot of turbulence as it goes. Another example of epithelial tissue would be in the intestines. Lining the intestines, there's a layer of cells that are really good at absorbing things. So cells that are very specialized for taking up nutrients and water. Those cells belong to a layer of epithelial tissue right there in the intestines. Another example would be the cells that are present in the kidneys. And they can do a really good job of secreting waste products, getting rid of waste products, taking waste products from the blood and passing it into the urine. So another location where there's a lining inside of the kidneys that allow this to happen. And then last on this list of examples, epithelial tissue also does a great job, mentioned this in passing already, great job of synthesizing and secreting important materials. And if this is the job, to synthesize and secrete, then we would say that this type of epithelia is glandular. So think of a gland. What does a gland do? It secretes something. And there are two major categories of glands. So we're going to introduce the names here. We could talk about exocrine glands, or we could talk about endocrine glands. And I have a picture coming up on the next slide to correspond with each of these. But basically with an exocrine gland, what it does is it's secreting something it could be to the surface of the body, it could be to an external surface or to an internal surface. So for example, sweat glands, these would be exocrine glands. They secrete substances out through a duct out to the surface of the skin. We would also have exocrine glands in our intestinal tracts. They produce digestive enzymes and secrete them internally into the hollow cavity inside of our intestines. Endocrine glands, on the other hand, they produce substances, but they secrete them internally. So what ends up happening is the bloodstream picks them up, picks up the substances that are secreted, and circulates them through the body. So this is how a lot of our hormones are produced and taken up, is through endocrine glands. So let's go ahead and take a look on the next slide here. Still talking about epithelial tissues, there are a lot of different varieties of epithelial tissues, and some of the ways that they can be classified are according to the shape of the cells that are involved. So if you just take a look at these three pictures here, what do you notice about the cells? In this case, the cells are very squished and flat. In this case, they're kind of like little cubes. And in this case, they're sort of stretched out. They're very tall. And there are names for each of those three varieties. So the first way that we can classify epithelial tissue is according to cell shape. These flattened cells, these are called squamous epithelial cells. Squamous. These ones that look like little cubes are, not surprisingly, called cuboidal epithelium. excuse me. And then finally, down here, these would be called columnar epithelial cells. Each of the cells looks like a little column. It's a column-shaped cell. So these different shapes have different functions. It turns out that squamous cell epithelium is really good for allowing diffusion to take place. It's not a very thick cell layer, so it really allows diffusion to happen easily. These are the cell types that line the lungs, for example, so it allows very efficient gas exchange. Coming down to the cuboidal epithelium, these do a lot of sort of secreting and absorbing of materials. These are the types of cells that line the kidneys, the tubules. So they allow for wastes to be secreted into the urine, and they also allow us to reabsorb things like water that we don't want to just flush out in the urine. So kind of multitasking cells there. And then the columnar epithelium, a lot of times these types of cells are specialized for producing things like mucus. So these are the cell types that line, for example, the intestines. And there are special cells called goblet cells that actually produce the mucus that allows food to slide nicely through the intestines. So the other thing that we need to consider with epithelial tissue, in addition to the cell shape, we also need to consider how many layers of cells are there. So in some places in the body, there are just simply individual layers of cells, like this picture right here. But in other locations, we might have squamous cells that are stacked on top of each other, like this over here. And the way that we would refer to those two different varieties is we would say that this is simple squamous epithelium. This one is stratified squamous epithelium. So if we have multiple layers of cells, we call that being stratified. So we could talk about stratified squamous epithelium or stratified cuboidal epithelium. So we can start to combine these two different classification schemes in order to be really specific about what we're talking about. So you can see some examples over here for different locations in the body where these different epithelial tissues show up. We will, of course, be exploring different organs and organ systems as we go throughout the semester. And now, at this point, we'll be able to use these names and you'll understand, oh, okay, that's what that means. So let's just wrap this up with this slide up with taking a look at these glands down here. I mentioned there are two different types of glands. Here is an exocrine gland. Okay, so these cells down in this area are producing something, and they secrete it out into this duct, which ends up leading to the surface. So that's an exocrine gland. Now let's contrast that with this one over here. Over on this side, we have gland cells, which are producing things, but there's no direct pathway out to the surface. Instead, they just kind of produce the material, and then it hangs out in these tissues, and the blood flow kind of wicks it away. The blood flow ends up picking up those substances and carrying it off into circulation. So that's an endocrine gland right there. One more thing I forgot to note while we were talking about stratified epithelium. Stratified epithelium is very good at protecting things. So think of your skin. Your skin has many layers of cells, and that's a good thing, because if you brush up against the couch or something, it's okay if the top layer of cells kind of gets abraded off even. You've still got a lot more layers of cells that are providing protection. Simple epithelium, on the other hand, this is more delicate, so this is not so good for protection against abrasions, but it is very good for allowing functionality like diffusion or producing mucus. So anyway, different locations throughout the body will have these different varieties present. In order for cells to be able to work together as tissues, they have to be able to be connected in some way. And there are a few different types of special connections that can exist between epithelial cells. They're called cell junctions, and we're going to take a look at three of them here. So first off, we have tight junctions, And just like the name implies, this type of a junction doesn't allow anything to pass through, really. It truly is a very tight junction between two neighbor cells. And this provides some special characteristics. For example, if there are special proteins embedded in this side of the cell membrane, then they will not be able to diffuse over through that tight junction. They can't do that. They will not be able to diffuse over to this side. So we can actually have specialization on the two surfaces of this cell. And that's the case for cells that line the intestines in the digestive tract. We have one side of our cells that are really specialized for absorbing nutrients, and we have another surface of the cell that's really specialized for passing things into the bloodstream. We'll come back to that later on in the semester, but that's just one example of a location where tight junctions are very useful, is in the intestinal tract. An adhesion junction, this is the next cell junction type. Adhesion junctions allow for some flexibility. So you can see these two adjacent cells, they're side by side. They are connected by protein filaments. Protein filaments are sort of reaching across and anchoring these cells together. But there's some flexibility allowed here. So this is really important if you have a tissue that needs to be able to stretch. If there was no flexibility here, then that would cause a problem. So this is a good type of junction for tissues that need to be able to stretch. And then the third type of cell junction over here is called a gap junction. And as you can see, in this case, the two neighbor cells have actually a channel that is directly connecting them, directly connecting the cytoplasm of the two adjacent cells. So this is interesting. This means that these cells can share materials. Ions are free to flow through the gap junction, and that's actually very important. Coming back to heart tissue, for example, the way that heart cells coordinate and beat together in unison is through the use of a gap junction. They send signals very quickly that way. So that's another special type of cell junction that epithelial tissues might make use of. Just beneath epithelial tissue, we have what's called a basement membrane. And this is just a substance. It's made of proteins that are secreted by the epithelial cells and also by the cells just beneath, which is usually the type of connective tissue. We'll come to that next. But the basement membrane is what helps to hold the epithelial tissue in place. So it kind of anchors it to whatever substrate is right beneath it. So that helps to give some support, some structural support, so that the epithelial tissue doesn't just sort of break off and float away. It stays put right where it's supposed to be.